Okay, so good evening. Welcome you all to the Hong Kong Arts Centre. I am Teresa Kwong from the Hong Kong Arts Centre. So sitting, standing on my left-hand side is Dr. Almuth from the Goethe Institute of Hong Kong. So maybe I briefly introduce what we are going to experience tonight. As a contemporary art center, Hong Kong Art Center committed to promote contemporary art and contemporary art experience. So that's why we always hoping to present new experience and new artistic artwork to the local audience. So that's why 3 years ago we launched a project called ArtX, which aimed to hopefully bring in new artistic experience to the local audience. This year is an unusual year, but still we still hope to continue our ArtX program. So before actually it's a late night program taking place here in this building, and we try to explore different space and different time zone. Hopefully, you know, the audience could have a new experience. But this year, because of all the restriction, whatever, we then transform it into a free evening. It's going to be an online, as we said, is an online interdisciplinary art experience. So today is Saturday, actually, is our second event. We have a lot of interesting program, including, say, for example, tonight here we are going to experience an interactive concert, and later on in our other space we will have online screening, we will have a tour, and also we are going to have an interactive theater. So hopefully you could stay tuned with all our promotion and enjoy our ArtX program. So talking about tonight's event here at the cinema, we are very much excited because we have this conversation. I remember back in last November, yes. Because I learned from Dr. Almuth that this year will be a special year for the Beethoven, and so that's why they would like to, you know, bring an extraordinary new experience to reinterpret Beethoven, you know, the master, the music master, the music again. So in a way, that's very, you know, kind of echo to what Art Center is doing, is hopefully have a new reinterpretation, yeah, about the classic. So maybe I now pass the mic to Dr. Almuth, and maybe she could tell us more about this interactive concert. It's what it is about, and also we are very happy to have three artists involved in this performance.
Exactly. Thank you, Teresa, and a very warm welcome also on behalf of the Goethe Institute. I'm Utmaya Zollitsch, head of the Goethe Institute, and actually this year, music lovers all around the world are celebrating the 250th birthday of the great composer Ludwig van Beethoven. So Beethoven's music is immortal, but we were thinking when the anniversary was approaching, how can we give a more contemporary and innovative approach to his music? And that was when we were talking about it, and I came across the artist duo Varvara Guljajeva and Mark Harnett. It's an artist duo based in Estonia, in Tallinn, and they are active on international level, invited to media art festivals and to artist residencies. And during an artist residence in Berlin at the Public Art Lab, they developed the first prototype of this interactive music installation. And so we thought, oh, this could be a really interesting access to Beethoven's music. Also because Beethoven, as you might know, became more and more deaf during his life. So we thought giving a visual impression of Beethoven's music could also be an honor to the great composer. So I would like to briefly explain how this is going to work. You see this interactive concert installation, and actually we developed this piece and commissioned it to Varvara and Ma. They developed the piece and this installation, and it is co-curated by Public Art Lab in Berlin and co-presented with Hong Kong Art Center here during the ArtX Night of Innovative Digital Technologies.
Actually, this is the Asia premiere for this concert, right?
It is the Asia premiere. Yeah. The installation will later travel to Seoul and presented also there. And of course, it was our wish to have the artists here with us, but that couldn't happen due to COVID-19. But digital technology at least helped us to have this interactive and intercontinental concert installation. So the idea of this installation is, Varvara and Ma are working at the intersection of neuroscience and media art. So the idea is, the pianist will wear a headset, a special EEG headset. And as you know, during listening to music and also even more during performing music, the brain waves are extremely active. And these brain waves are then sent online to a supercomputer in Tallinn. And the brain waves are there transformed into electric impulses. And these electric impulses actually are activating a knitting machine. A very old-fashioned, but of course digitally updated, circular knitting machine, which will then, during the concert and during the play of the pianist, tick, 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 slowly knitting a scarf. So we will have a visual and even tactical result of the music. And at the same time, on another screen, the brain waves will also be recorded and be made visible through a graphic program. So we will have two screens, and Varvara and Ma, both artists, are now online, and in Tallinn, they will mix the images from both sides, so from the knitting machine and also the graphic images. And after the show, after the concert, they will be with us for an artist conversation. And we will then get a little bit more insight into how this works, because of course it's a very sophisticated media installation, and it's very interesting to know and fascinating to know how this works. But first of all, of course, we want to give the stage to Ludwig van Beethoven and to a wonderful sonata that Linda Yim will play for us. Linda Yim is a Hong Kong-based pianist. She is member of the Hong Kong New Music Ensemble and currently teaches piano at the Hong Kong Baptist University and the Education University of Hong Kong. She is proactive in promoting both classical and contemporary music. So that was why we were so lucky to find her, and she is open to this experimental concert installation and will play for us with this device, which was also a bit unusual for you in the first moment. We will later talk with you also how you feel this during this experiment. So Linda is regularly performing with Hong Kong-based ensembles like Chinese Orchestra, Hong Kong Chinese Orchestra, Hong Kong Philharmonic Orchestra, Hong Kong Bach Choir, and today she will perform here for us the famous Piano Sonata number 17 in D minor, The Tempest. It is consisting of three movements. The first is Largo, Allegro, so it starts slowly and then becomes very vibrant, Adagio, and Allegretto. So now the stage is yours, dear Linda, and we will enjoy this wonderful music and watch what is happening in your brain.
Thank you. No, you've been good. Ah, now they will show the video.
Thank you very much for listening, and of course a very warm thank you to Linda for this wonderful performance of the great music of Ludwig van Beethoven. I think before we start with the conversation with Vava and Ma to know what is behind all this installation, I would like to ask first question to Linda. How did you feel with this strange thing on your head? How was it for you to perform, to play music with this headset?
Hi. this is a very unique experience for me because I never tried anything like this. And when we were went through our first dress rehearsal last week. That was I was a little bit worrying about it, and then we find out that a way that the headset doesn't move. So I think the headset is very light, and it doesn't. I couldn't feel much of the weight of the headset, and I can still enjoy my playing, and just try not to think about my. Think about more concentrate and focus more on the music.
You have this. You need one contact point, I think. No, this is maybe
the
interesting
forehead.
To know for the viewers. Maybe when you show it, where you have to get the contact.
The contact point is here.
On the forefront.
Yeah, here. So when we're trying to wear the headset, if I move this contact point too low, then the brainwave will be quite weak.
Yeah.
So between the first and second movement, I try to adjust the position of this
to really capture the.
Yeah.
The
so I try to reposition that.
Mm-hmm.
So here is really the contact point of my brainwave, and then to the artist.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I think, we were also very intrigued by, what the actual kneading would look like. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think later on, if, Vera and Mark, we see it on the screen, I would like to know about the pattern and also about If talking about a wearable scarf, how much time do we have to play in order to have, in order to got certain length?
Yes, yeah. Of course. This is this would be really interesting. I think
it seems they're here. Yeah.
Oh, great!
Hey.
Welcome. Hello. Very warm welcome. Welcome to Hong Kong.
Yeah. So. I think we almost have a, well, even though, yeah, because to here in Hong Kong, we have a 75% capacity, policy. It seems that we almost have a lot of audience here.
Yes, they are all curious to know more about this unique concert installation. What we already noticed from your video was it does not only work with Beethoven, but also with Bach, and most probably also with jazz or rock music. Maybe then the brainwaves will, will be even more active. Yes, can you elaborate a little bit more about your concept and about this media installation?
Sure. Well, first of all, thank you for all the technical support and Linda for playing. We are very happy that everything worked because, a connection can go wrong, many things can go wrong, and data in between and so on. It was kind of very great, and a bit like excitement is up at the moment or already going down. But talking about the project, as Almuth, you mentioned, it looked like we have knit through all great German composers almost, starting with Bach, we have been also to Austria, knitted the Mozart, and now we are knitting in the very important year also the Beethoven. When we decided let's use knitting for a bit more experimental ways, then we discovered with neuro knitting, when we were first knitting Sebastian Bach, then that it's really performative medium. And we wanted kind of to bring it somehow on stage, and then, 7 years later, here we are. finally doing what we had at that point in mind, but maybe in different ways, of course. We have also prepared for you the slides. I don't know if we share the screen. What do you think?
Yes. Yes. Okay. Very good idea. Yeah. Thank you.
Now. Okay. First, before jumping to explain what today's concept was, we thought we give you a bit story behind, because as we were introduced, we are media artists and not knitters. Our journey to knitting started in 2012. When we had this brilliant idea to make from spam poetry and then to give it a knitted form, and we didn't know anything about knitting at that time, and we saw one documentation of a knitting machine hack on Brother 930 by Make magazine, and we thought, we could kind of expand our creative horizons with this, and we decided to join first digital waste with first digital fabrication tool at home, which was knitting machine, and we then started to knit dysfunctional wearables with a spam poetry on it. So first we knitted kind of canvas-like things, and which look like sweaters, but you cannot wear them. Mm-hmm. And the poetry on them, it looks like a bit dadaistic and reminds vocabulary of spam, because people were actually donating us their spam. We made an email when we were in residency, we need your spam at gmail.com, and collecting. I hope nobody became spammer, like classified as spammer after our great participative experiment. But we also needed then more sculptoric or performative pieces, which this one you can wear, but you need a partner for this. And then one with very long sleeve, like 3 meters long, but all of them, we follow this concept of dysfunctional wearable. So here you can also see our knitting machine. Well, you saw also on the in the video of neuro knitting, where then until the from the spam poetry until the neuro knitting, we were using this Brother 930 and 40 machines, where we even kind of upgraded and made our own electronics for this. But of course, I mean, it's kind of limited. I mean, first of all, the machine is only done originally for floppy. Like you could upload your pattern only using floppy disk drives, and nowadays nobody have them. Not the common or normal users. And then we wanted to knit real time and from the computer, and so we developed our own electronics for this. And also after the spam poetry, we wanted kind of, because when knitting is kind of connected with craft, and everyone thing is kind of very traditional, and there is no innovation behind. And we wanted kind of a bit spice up maybe this field. So we thought like, why not to borrow some concepts maybe from neuroscience, because in 2013, this field kind of became a bit hype, I would say. Everyone was talking about this. First, accessible or affordable headsets appeared. And also what is important, that we could also grab the data behind. So maybe Mar, you want a bit elaborate on this?
Yeah, basically these headsets, they have like interfaces that making little programs, you can gather the state of mind of the persons, like relaxation or cognitive load or meditation levels. Much more things that you can calculate it with especially with the new artificial intelligence.
Yes. When we started, we more treated them as experiments, because for us it was. When we documented our project, then a lot of disciplines became very much interested, and various blogs and magazines were writing about from craft, design, art, until the neuroscience magazine. So it was kind of great that everyone found something interesting there. And so we made several iterations. So first we needed, while listening to the Sebastian Bach music, we collaborated with this on this project with Sebastian Miaia, who used to be a part of Tangible Music Group in Pompeu Fabra University in Barcelona. And their research group found found out that the brain reacts the best on music, because normally we have a lot of noise inside our brain and it takes kind of some time to train this very repetitive task in order to see the pattern. But this music is way easier to get kind of this reaction. So we were invited to the residency in Salzburg. In the middle, we also changed our knitting technique with every kind of new new music, let's say like this. So there we went a bit further, that not only Mozart music, but also places and spaces connected with Mozart. We were recording there the brainwaves. And the third one, we tried this football, and our collaborator told that, well, brain doesn't react very well on football, so we should use something
else.
Yeah,
we recorded in the Clásico, which is the Barça Madrid, is the kind of the more important match of the season on the Spanish league.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and well, as I told you before, that this old, maybe discontinued knitting machine is a bit limited, although we managed to upgrade it with our electronics and so on. We always had this vision to build our own knitting machine, which could be reproducible using the digital fabrication tools. We call it soft digital fabrication when the soft garment is produced. So we wanted also to have textile fabrication in this field. So we made a circular knitting machine, and well, when you ask why, then circular is really like made for automatic or autonomous performance, because it's more stable. It's there is less possibilities that the yarn drops and so on. So and also, we always are kind of fascinated, or we wanted to make a knitting machine knit pattern. Well, for this performance, we then upgraded our circular knitting machine, and we added a spray mechanism, which then now explaining this work, which reacts on pianist attention level. So the higher attention level, more it sprays the yarn, or actually dyes the yarn, using the vocabulary of textile designers. And then it is then knitted inside the produced garment. You can see also like affecting the outcome. And the speed of the knitting machine is connected with the meditation level of musician. So why doing this? Well, normally if you come to the traditional classical music concert, then we would hear the interpretation of the musicians composer's piece. But we wanted to feel, to sense something even more. And first, of course, it's kind of EEG data, you could say, like, well, what it can tell us and so on. But not even like knowing Linda personally, unfortunately, because we are not there. We just rehearse. We have rehearsed on distance. I can feel how she feels the music through the data, and also like knitting machine just behind here, like performing together with her, because especially, for instance, the third chapter, which is much more like complex to play, for instance, the attention level is always like super high, and at certain point, like in the middle, she, for instance, she relaxes more, and you can also see from knitting machine that it's okay, it moves slower, there are not so much dyeing the yarn going on, and yeah, we also learned quite a lot, because in the beginning we thought, well, we do this interactive process and let's see what data is doing, but in the end we felt like we are also feeling the music through the emotional state of the pianist. And well, also
that sounds, yeah, fascinating. Maybe come back for a moment on this issue with the black dots, because I noticed that there were some black dots in the red in the red scarf, and I thought, oh, maybe there you have some I don't know, some fleas in the room or something. But what was it actually? Is this story with spraying ink into the yarn? Or
It's kind of it's really marking the peaks of attention of musician when playing the piece.
The piece.
Yeah. So and I don't know
peak, at the peak of the attention, then this ink shots in.
Yeah, then there's the spray mechanism is
activated.
It's activated, yeah. And then from, I mean, if we change the camera, we could also see the garment, because what garment in a way acts as a the database of emotions during the performance, because it leaves the mark there.
Yeah.
And maybe to explain a little bit the visuals, if you want.
Yes.
In the visuals, there is there is three chapters, like Barbara was mentioning, and with the dialogue we had also in the rehearsal, we make the changes, and there is like the brain data. It became on the is displayed also in this roundish like form that is inside, and also is affecting the music, the visuals that are displayed, where actually in the first chapter is about the storm, in the second is about fog, and in the last is about clouds. And this is generated in artificial intelligence. And yeah, I hope that you enjoy it while it was like doing the visuals too.
Yeah, there is. We were also taking the audio input, the microphone, and the visualization of brain data. You could see with a white circle in the foreground, which we decided to go along with circular aesthetics. Yeah. Not because we understand that from the audience point of view, there are many processes to follow, so it was kind of also when we were creating all this visual setup, we tried to take into account that there is interesting things to follow, but also you don't get visually overwhelmed, plus you have also real like live music performance.
Yeah, and also that there is progression, that you see the three chapters is progressing also in the visuals.
Coming back to Teresa's question, I'm also interested to know, how long does it take to, I don't know, to knit a scarf, or how many centimeters are you producing during a concert? Maybe you share this with us.
I can show you.
It's a fun fact, maybe.
Yeah, can we switch to this another camera? Then I can show.
Yeah, we will be intrigued. Say, for example, we just have a 20-minute piano performance. You know, how? You know, what is the length that we got? That yeah. Oh.
This is not fun.
I think I will
we
guess that
this. We had already the rehearsal about, last week, maybe.
This is from the rehearsals, but the red one we changed it in before the performance. I will guess it's like 1 meter or seven in between 75 and 1 meter centimeters. It was produced during the performance.
Wow.
Because the orange is rehearsal and the blue was the rehearsal just in the morning. And the red is the one that it was actually in the real performance.
That's super interesting.
Yeah, it's because our original idea is to have the two artists coming to Hong Kong and together with the kneading machine. And we will, you know, physically we could weakness and or touch the knee, you know, the scarf. And maybe we were thinking initially in inviting the audience to be on stage and having the headset, and maybe they could have their own, you know, knitting pattern. But unfortunately, you know, we could not do it this time. But actually, so that's why I have a question for both artists. Thank you for bringing this, you know, Asia premiere here. This is our honor. We understand initially this is a physical, you know, everything will be physical, is an offline interactive concert installation. But this time, because of the COVID, we have to make it as a hybrid mode. That means that both online and offline. So my question is, definitely this is a challenge for you, but other than difficulty, would that be a positive thing? Would that be in another way, you know, give you other insight to bring to this work to maybe, you know, another level? Yeah. So both challenge and possibility that the situation bring to you and to this work. So what are they?
I think I can speak for me. I think that it is a challenge, and definitely we will not have tried this format if the COVID-19 will not hit us. But I think it's very interesting that we research in these directions, because many things can be done. And I think was interesting results what we achieved today, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I think it would be definitely, from experience point of view, and the audience, if all the processes would happen at the same place and space. But you know, you have to come up with solutions if there is problems, right? So we together with Goethe Institute and the Hong Kong Arts Center, we were discussing for a while, like how to do this hybrid performance. Like, shall we ship knitting machine, or shall we do everything in video? But I think we found kind of quite like optimal solution in a way, how to do this performance, and having like a part streamed to Hong Kong, and then data traveling here to our studio and affecting from Hong Kong, affecting our machine here, and through this, if it's just not only the video, but all these, let's say, materials, process materials. Yeah. We almost don't feel the distance. We are there with you. I guess as nervous as Linda when playing, and this I think adds to this all telematic situation that we need something more, just an image. It added us the work, but I think it's the result is worse of it.
Absolutely. Thank you. I would like to open up the floor to the audience, and we have also some guests from School of Creative Media, and I may mention that you both have been artists in residence at the School of Creative Media here in Hong Kong. In the remote version during the first month of COVID. And we have Professor Christian Sandor from, he is the director of the Expanded Reality Lab of City University School of Creative Media here with us. And I think also some of the students. May we ask if you have some questions to Barbara and Ma regarding this installation.
Yeah. All right, thank you very much for your presentation and the great you know, performance just now. Just a question from me, actually. You know, I saw some brainwaves on the screen together with, you know, the knitting machine. And, you know, I was just wondering, like, sometimes I see, you know, just a bit of dense, you know, brain waves there, but sometimes there are some overlapped and very strong ones. And how do you transform these to, you know, to the scarf? And, you know, for different brain waves, how do you, you know, make it into different shapes into the scarf?
Like what we display is actually the raw brainwave data, which is everything there. But then you have to unentangle this data with artificial intelligence, and then you get the other things that you can actually process it. And what we were getting, like Barbara is saying, is the meditation level and the
yeah. Well, meditation level is mapped to the speed, so we have 10 different speed for according to the level, and then attention, if it's passes certain threshold, it's triggers the dying process of the yarn. This way we get patterns which kind of, it's a stamp of like emotional state in a way.
And also to say that we were at the beginning planning to use, for example, another headset with more electrodes, but also due to the to do remotely, we're thinking that the setup will be complicated without us there. We were planning to use a Unicorn EGG that has 8 electrodes and it has a little bit more data even than this one. But anyway, this EGG is actually pretty much used for sometimes for doing yoga classes and things like this, that it takes this kind of data quite cool.
Okay, shall we take one more question?
Yeah.
One last question, yeah, please.
Hi, that was great. Could I just ask a quick question in relation to, does the machine only work firstly when somebody is actually reacting to physical data? And also if you have perhaps tried the machine out when somebody is improvising in their mind only, and if there's any kind of comparison?
Yeah, there is a comparison. I mean, we were trying with our own brain data when we were here, and it's I would say it's pretty random, unless we start to kind of search for patterns, like trying to focus on something and trying to not focus. And for instance, we had, I think we had 3 rehearsals with Linda, and I see when she plays the same song, I see the same similarity, you know, I see the pattern there. And well, first when we had like this artistic idea, we were not sure that there is a pattern, but we wanted to connect it with a knitting pattern. But now I clearly see that it was really a right decision, because we are doing the pattern and there is a pattern in the mind. And also in music, so I think it's a perfect circle.
So, well, I mean, again, thank you, Vera and Mark, you know, for bringing, you know, such an interesting reinterpretation of Beethoven music. And also, yeah, thanks to Linda. Yeah, let's give a big hand to all of them, and also to Goethe Institute, you know, for introducing such an interesting artwork to us. So last but not the least, yeah, so this is, you know, coming to the end of, you know, neural knitting Beethoven performance, but our ArtX program is still going on. So after this, we are going to have, you know, few more online programs. Say, for example, starting from X15, we are going to have a virtual tour to the North Point, and we will bring you to, you know, some secret corner of a shopping mall, and in a way, it's related to the Hong Kong cinema. And then later on at 9 p.m., we are also going to show the documentary, a feature documentary by Andrew Heffler, who is the producer of the Oscar-winning best film, Moon Knight. And so you could go to our Facebook and also our Instagram, and you are going to see all these kind of exciting online program. And tomorrow, we will also continue ArtX. We're going to showcasing some online and offline programs. So hopefully you could stay tuned with us. And also, we also very treasure all your feedback to our program. So here we will also have a QR code where you could fill in the survey, and hopefully you could give us some feedback about today's program, and maybe you could also give us some program suggestion where maybe in the future, is there any new artistic experience you could also feel free to propose to us. And second, not the least is very important. It's our center is a non-profit making independent organization, and we also have to rely on your support and donation. Say, for example, this event, the Beta Film One, is a free program. But so thanks to the support to Goethe Institute to make it happen. But again, we hoped to rely on your support and donation, and hopefully we could continue to introduce more and more exciting program from all over the world. Yeah. Okay, so again, thank you for joining us tonight, and wish you all a happy Saturday evening. Yeah.